Back in 1969, Congressman George Bush said, we need to make population and family planning household words. He said it. But President George Bush hasn't done much about it, and he's now threatening to veto the whole U.S. foreign aid budget, mainly because the Congress insists on putting in it a measure granting $20 million to the U.S. Population Fund, a fund set up to slow population growth around the world. Though population growth has lately begun to slow down in some countries, overall, the world's population still goes up by 1 million people every 4 days. In the next 50 years, it could double from 5 billion to 10 billion people. But President George Bush apparently doesn't worry much about that, nor would he or any of his colleagues in the White House even talk to us about it. What is it that we're talking about? Across the border from Texas, take a look at the garbage dumps of Mexico City. Mexico's population has soared far beyond its ability to feed itself or to dispose of its waste. Some of Mexico City's people have even had to take up residence in this literally stinking neighborhood. Here in the stench, they and their children scavenge for anything they can recycle. Some of the older dumps are now 180 feet deep. That's the height of an 18-story building. At the turn of the century, the population of Mexico City was 340,000. Today, it's more than 15 million, the second largest city on the planet. In the next two decades, it could, if it goes unchecked, double to 30 million. And like everywhere else, the slums grow fastest. 12 miles from the center of Mexico City, this is Chimalhuacan, one of a series of towns that have grown up in the last four decades in what is called the Cinturón de Miseria, the belt of misery around Mexico City. This area used to be the bed of a saltwater lake. They drained it. Today it is home to more than 250,000 people, and the living here is far from easy. Since there are no sewers in many of these slums, like Chimalhuacan, tons of human waste get picked up and spewed by the wind into the polluted air that bathes this area. And that, of course, spreads disease.
Now,
Manuel Guerra is an expert on Mexico City's pollution. Without radical change, he says, there can only be disaster ahead.
300 tons of fecal matter is deposited on the eastern side of Mexico City every day. 300 tons of fecal matter.
Because there aren't sufficient sewers.
Exactly. So the death rate here of infants is the highest in the Republic, here in this part of the city.
Right here?
Right here. You just cannot cope. There is no system in the world that could cope rationally with this type of growth.
Time was Mexico had enough land to feed its population. No longer. And they are decimating their forests, too. And they have depleted Mexico City's water supply so rapidly that the city itself is sinking. Most of the rivers and streams have been turned into malodorous sewers, like this one bordering Chimalhuacan.
This is the sewer of Mexico City.
It's the ugliest piece of water I have ever seen in my life.
Yes, it's a completely dead body of water with many chemicals, with the sewage of many millions of homes, and also even bodies and everything is thrown into the river.
Yes, I've seen dogs and cats, and I hear occasionally the kids find
humans.
Yet much of that water is used untreated for irrigating vegetable farms around Mexico City.
For vegetables, carrots, lettuce, and so on. We have an enormous problem there.
Wait, this is a filthy river.
Yes, it is.
And it is used to irrigate vegetables?
Exactly.
What does this
that
do
has been
to the
done
vegetables?
For well, they grow very nicely. They grow very big, but very polluted.
Maybe it's a stupid question, but how can Mexico permit that?
Well, it just overgrew.
It certainly did. Take a look at the family of Dolores and Raul Basilio, who came here to Mexico City, to the slum of Chimalhuacan, 6 years ago. They have 10 children.
Yes, sir.
Dolores is the family's main breadwinner, scavenging for cardboard cartons to sell. On a good day, she makes about $8. And her neighbors consider her lucky, for more than 1 million people are added to Mexico's workforce each year, and less than half of them can find jobs. Why did Dolores have 10 children?
Your husband wanted this many children?
That's just the way we Mexicans are, he says.
But we like that.
In the countryside where they came from, family planning was almost unknown. Here, people have twice as many children as in the cities.
Some of them don't really want them, but they think that's part of life. Nothing you can do about it.
Others feel that they need for their old age, they need children to help support them.
Adrian Lajoux is a Mexican expert on the population dilemma.
Some men want their women pregnant all the time, so they won't cheat on them. That's their feeling.
Even today?
Even today.
It's a badge of honor among men that your wife does not take...
That's right. Or that you have a lot of children. You're muy macho.
It's the grandfather of all the problems we have. It is to a great degree in developed countries. It is totally in the case of developing countries whose population is growing.
And yet, believe it or not, compared to other developing nations, Mexico is a success story in family planning. For years, health workers have been plying the slum streets, like here in Chimalhuacan, distributing birth control pills and condoms and advice on family planning. They are part of a huge campaign backed by government and private organizations that has already reduced the population growth rate in Mexico by one-third, and that growth rate keeps declining, as it has begun to lately in many parts of the world, which bears out what the population experts have been saying, that the majority of women, given the chance, want to have fewer children.
After 25 years of work in this field, we know how to bring down birth rates around the world.
Dr. Sharon Camp heads a private Washington lobbying group, the U.S. Population Crisis Committee.
We know people want family planning. We know governments around the world want to slow population growth. It's a matter of getting together the political will. And the biggest political obstacles are not here in Mexico City, where they've got strong leadership. They're in Washington. They're in the White House.
How come? The U.S. used to play a leading role in promoting family planning around the world. George Bush, when he was ambassador to the U.N., said, quote, success in the population field under U.N. leadership may determine whether we can resolve successfully the other great questions of peace, prosperity, and individual rights that face the world. But after that, back in 1984, under pressure from the powerful anti-abortion lobby, the Reagan White House, with George Bush as vice president, enunciated two new policies.
One was that the United States government no longer thinks population problems are very important. And number two, the United States government is so abhorred by abortion that we are going to deny help with contraception to any organization that provides any assistance to abortion at all.
Which meant the U.S. cut all support of the U.N. Population Fund, even though that fund was never directly promoting abortion. And it also ended support of the International Planned Parenthood Association. These are the two major population planning organizations worldwide.
That is dictated, you say, by
his fear of the anti-abortion lobby.
Pressured by Congress, the Bush administration still gives money to individual countries for family planning, but the U.S. is no longer considered a leading force in the fight to control population growth around the world.
Yes, he is not, I think, willing to rile up the hard right in order to deal forthrightly with the world population problem.
Certainly not before election time.
As we said earlier, no one from the White House would respond to any of this. What is the role of the Catholic Church in all this? Well, in Mexico, unlike in other countries, the church has largely stayed out of the debate.
The priests in the confessional know that their people, their women that come to confession, are using family planning, want to use it, and will continue to use it. And if they get too tough, they'll go look for another priest to confess to.
Yeah, but the Pope was here, what, a year ago, and talking against family planning.
But the local priest won't.
Trying to stop population growth runs up against other big problems. The paradox that while governments like Mexico's battle to control population, at the same time, they spend huge amounts on medical care to try to keep every child born alive. So while Mexico's birth rate has fallen dramatically, its death rate has dropped even more. And many of Mexico's young women, because of better health, are able to have children at an ever earlier age, which means that the next few years could see the largest baby boom the world has ever known.
This is the most critical decade in all of human history in terms of stopping population growth, because it is what we do in this decade, in the next 10 years, that will virtually determine whether we have a world population that is twice the size of this one or three times the size of this one. And a population three times the size of this one is certain to be an ecological disaster.
The Mexican government is spending big money trying to cope with the population growth. New roads and sewers and hospitals and schools. But these facilities are continually swamped by the growing demand. The more people, the more problems that come with them. The air blanketing the city is charged with chemical poisons. Breathing in this city, some say, is equivalent to smoking a pack of cigarettes a day. The U.S. Embassy offers Americans a hardship bonus just for living here. The Germans tell their diplomats to leave their kids at home in Germany.
And what about the people in Seattle or Boston or Dallas, Texas? Why should they care about what the problem is here in Mexico or in India or in Tanzania?
Well, in part because Mexicans live next door to us, and some of that stuff that's flowing down the Grand Canal is going to end up off our beaches. Some of the things that are in the air over Mexico are going to contribute to global environmental problems like climate change. Mm-hmm. Their future is our future. And unless we help them develop economically and slow down the rate of population growth, we are going to leave to our children, American children, a world that is much more crowded, much more unstable, much more polluted, and much poorer, many parts of it.
And what about the role of George Bush in all this?
George Bush could solve the world population problem.
George Bush could?
George Bush is the person who could do this. He's likely to be president for most of this decade. And he doesn't have to spend a dime of taxpayers' money on abortion. That's not what this is about. But he cannot allow the anti-abortion lobby to dictate American policy in this area, which they have done for the last decade. We dithered away a whole decade, and now in the 1990s, we've got a much bigger job to do, a much bigger population problem, and the job is more urgent now. We're going to have to work really hard, and we have to do it right now. We don't have any time to waste.
As we said at the beginning of this report, President Bush is still planning to veto the entire U.S. foreign aid bill, mainly because the Congress has proposed reinstating aid to the U.N. Population Fund. We asked for George Bush, Barbara Bush, or John Sununu to comment about this. Through their spokespersons, they declined our invitation. Indeed, the White House declined to make available anyone from the administration to speak to this issue on camera.